Well, good evening to you. My Bible's open to 1 Peter chapter 4. If you'd open your Bible to 1 Peter chapter 4, we will end up there here in just a few minutes. I want to thank again the elders for the chance to get to be here again. And it's always really tough whenever I'm in the back and everybody's leaving, because I really want to have like a 30-minute conversation with each of you. That might be a bit of a challenge if we were to do that, but I just want you to know I really care about you all, and you all really mean a lot to me, and it's so good to get to be back with you again. 1 Peter chapter 4 is where we'll be here in just a second. I want to tell you about a story, though, that I was reading about an Indian tribe that went and asked their chief if it was going to be a cold winter. And this was a new chief. He wasn't very well versed in the ways of the old chiefs, and so he didn't really know how to answer that question. Is it going to be a cold winter? So he just thought, well, I'm going to play it safe. I'm going to say, yeah, it's going to be a cold winter. And so he tells his tribe, yeah, collect a lot of wood, because it's going to be a cold winter. Well, about a week went by, and he got on the phone, and he called the National Weather Service, and he asked the question. He says, is it going to be a cold winter? And that voice on the other end said, absolutely, it's going to be a cold winter. And so he went back to his tribe, and he said, you better collect a lot of wood. It's going to be a cold winter. And well, about a week passed again, and he called the National Weather Service again just to see if the prediction was the same. Maybe it had changed in a week, and they said, oh yeah, it's going to be a very cold winter, perhaps one of the coldest winters we've ever seen on record. And so he went back to his tribe, and he told him, he said, hey, listen, collect all the firewood that you possibly can. It's going to be a very cold winter. Well, one last time, he went back a week later, he called, and he asked that National Weather Service, he said, is it going to be a cold winter? And they said, it's going to be the coldest winter ever that we've ever seen. And he said, I just got a question for you. How do you know that? He said, it's the Indians. They're collecting more firewood than ever before. I've never seen them collect so much. You know, I wonder sometimes if we hear things, maybe we even say things that we believe to be true, but in fact are myths. We know, young and old, that we and our bodies were just not meant to last forever. And I would even venture to say that the older folks here tonight probably are reminded every single day that your body is not meant to last forever. You have aches, you have pains. I'm already seeing some people nodding. You have reminders every day, parts of your body that just hurt, and maybe what doesn't hurt doesn't work, and you know what that is like. And that should cause, I think, all of us to wonder, is the life that we now have the only life that we will ever live? You know, there's a motto that society has embraced here lately. Very humanistic model, and some have raised up a generation who believe a little acronym, YOLO. YOLO. Now, if you're over the age of about 25, you probably have no idea what YOLO means. If you're under the age of 25, then I suspect you know exactly what YOLO means. You see, YOLO is an acronym for the phrase, you only live once. And as I studied this phrase, I come to find out that this saying really kind of shot to fame based off of an entertainer who used this phrase in one of his songs, used the term YOLO, and it's kind of become a phrase to describe all sorts of reckless behavior, all kinds of reckless living. Should I drink all this alcohol at the bar? Well, you only live once, so you might as well. Should I try this new drug? Well, why not? YOLO, you only live once. Should I buy these new shoes? Or should I pay my rent? Well, YOLO, right? You only live once. I believe that young people are buying into this line every day because they've been told that maybe they're just an accident, that they're just an accident from a big bang. There's no difference between them and just a few billion years of blind chance. That's what people are coming to believe. And if you dig into this philosophy of YOLO, what you're going to find out is that it did not begin with an entertainer. It did not begin with Darwin. It didn't begin with Freud. Anybody related in the psychology department at Western Kentucky University? It, in fact, began with Satan himself. And we might even ask the question, well, why would you only live once? Why would that be one of Satan's most popular myths to circulate? Well, I want you to consider tonight this principle. I want you to consider that this evening is that your life's choices are influenced by your view of life's length. I want you to think about that, the way we live. Think about it even just as Christians. The way that we live that way because of our belief in where our life is going, where we're headed. It's interesting that in some of the school systems I've come to learn and come to find out that in this country they teach a very humanistic world view that you only live once, that you're nothing more than just a germ. But then they go And they teach you that you need to have some good morals as well. Maybe in the next class, maybe a student will go to one class. They say, well, you need to have good morals. You need to treat people right. You need to be an honest person. They might tell them that you need to be a person of integrity. You need to have good morals. And then the very next class, they go and they are told that they're just some evolved germ. In another class, another teacher tells them that. Understand tonight that those two principles just cannot go together. They can't. You know, why should we accept any sort of value system if this life is all there is, right? Why should we have any values in our life here in Russellville at all? You see, if this life is all there is, then there is only one thing to live for. And you know what that is? It's me. It's only living for me and only living for you and what you want. And if I only live once, why would I deny any of the desires that my earthly body, my flesh, has? If I only live once, why would I ever say no to something that I was presented with? Well, turn your Bible to 1 Peter chapter 4, if you will, if you're not already there. Let's read the first five verses together, because I want you to look at this passage in 1 Peter chapter 4. Peter's writing to a group of Christians in now modern Turkey, a real place. And he reminds them throughout this letter that they are just pilgrims. They're just strangers, that they're sojourners. They're also called aliens. They don't belong on this earth anymore. He tells them that they're traveling to another place, and he reminds them that as pilgrims, now the way they're thinking, their view has changed. Look down at your New Testament there at 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1. It says, since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. For the time is past, suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, lawless idolatry. With respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you. But they will give an account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. You know, sometimes we look out in our society and we see people making all kinds of foolish decisions, the things that they decide to do with their life. And we may ask the question, well, why is it that people live the lives they live? Why is it that people make the choices they do? Or why is it that they decide to go one direction over the other? I'll tell you, because they have pushed the thought of eternity. They push that out of their minds, the thought they've forgotten completely about the concept of judgment and where history is heading. They've just blocked that out of their minds. You see, your choices really reveal what I believe, what you believe about judgment and what eternity is going to be like. And so the question is tonight that I'm asking you is this life that we now have the only life that we will ever have? You know, young people in our society are told, carpe diem, seize the day. Live as if there's no tomorrow. Just eat and drink and be merry, for tomorrow we die. And if you only live once, then you should just live your life looking out for yourself. Why look out for somebody else? Just grab some happiness wherever you can find it. Basically, if you only live once, why not be self-absorbed with yourself? Why not only think about what's going to be best for you? It's amazing. We see in Luke chapter 12, if you'd be turning your testament to Luke chapter 12, there's a man a lot like this in the Bible that we find. If you turn to Luke chapter 12, Jesus described a man in Luke chapter 12 who was in a very similar situation to this. It's in a parable that we find. A parable in Luke chapter 12. You might notice in verse 15, he starts and he says to them, Luke writes for us there, he says, and he said to them, take care and be on guard against all covetousness, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. Kind of talked about that this morning. And he told them a parable saying, the land of a rich man produced plentifully. And he thought to himself, well, what shall I do? For I have nowhere to store my crops. And he said, here's what I'll do. I will tear down my barns and build bigger ones, build larger ones. There I will store all my grain and my goods. I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many, many years. Relax. Eat, drink, and be merry. I mean, you see that? If that's all that life is about, is myself, and that this life's all there is, when Jesus calls us even then later on to deny ourselves, to take up our cross, follow him, well, does that make any sense? If this life is all there is? You see, Jesus taught something different. He didn't just teach about values and doing good. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, would talk a lot about eternity. He said a lot about heaven. And believe it or not, he actually said considerably a lot about hell. And we'll talk about that here in just a minute as well. But he consistently insisted that we are going from here to there. And, you know, you see, culture says live as if there's just no tomorrow. But Jesus comes along now and he says, well, there is a tomorrow. This place here, earth, this is only temporary. You see, Jesus believed that the external is much more important, that the eternal is much more important than the external, that there is more beyond this life. I was learning recently about a statue that you can actually find and go and see in Spain that was built just a few years ago in 1506. And it's in the city where Christopher Columbus, you might remember the explorer Christopher Columbus, it's where he died. And at the bottom of the statue, there are three words written in Latin, ne plus ultra. I practiced that all the way from Bowling Green, how to say those words. And those three words in English mean this right here, no more beyond. No more beyond. But the interesting thing is about that statue is that there's a lion that is depicted as eating the first word of the statue. So what do we have now? Well, more beyond. You see, for centuries, they thought that there was nothing more beyond Spain, right? Nothing more. But then Columbus comes along. He discovered that there is more beyond Spain. And in the sense of the word, there is more beyond. But when it comes to Jesus, when it comes to the Son of God, we can say that there is more beyond because of his resurrection, because of what he did. There is more beyond our existence here. And there are more important things to think about than just the external things. Do you remember what we talked about this morning? We talked about this morning in Matthew chapter 6 at verse 19. Matthew chapter 6 at verse 19. We said, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy. It's what people want to do when they don't realize this life is just temporary. Where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be. Also, Jesus comes along and Jesus says, don't invest everything that you have in earthly treasures because earthly treasures are going to deteriorate. They're going to disappear. But he says, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven because in heaven, nothing deteriorates. Nothing disappears. He's reminding his listeners, he's reminding his followers that there is more beyond this life. And he's insisting that they get their hearts focused on the world and the life to come, not just the physical world. Another place we look in Luke chapter 12, starting about verse 4, Jesus would also tell us, I tell you, my friends, do not fear those who kill the body, and after that, they have nothing more that they can do. But I will warn you whom to fear. Fear him who, after he is killed, has authority to cast into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. Jesus says, don't worry. Don't worry about those who can harm you physically. The only one that you should revere, the only one that you should have and put your focus on in this life is the one who will decide your eternal destiny. That's the one who your eyes should be on. That's the one who you need to consider. You see, eternity has gotten pushed out of people's minds, I believe, because we have just decided sometimes as Christians, we're going to fill our minds just with a whole bunch of junk and things that just really doesn't matter. But as Christians, as followers of Christ, we have to do something in our life. We have to prepare for what is coming. Are you preparing in your life for what is coming? And we need to make our life's choices by saying you only live once. That's a lie. That is not true. You know, most of us in this room tonight have been singing, this world is not my home. I'm what? I'm just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. But when do we walk out the doors and do we show that in our attitudes and in our actions? We've been singing that song a long time. You see, our citizenship, we understand, as Paul says in Philippians 3, is not the United States of America. That's not where our citizenship is. Ultimately, our citizenship is in heaven. We understand that. We understand that we're just pilgrims passing through, and the choices we make need to reflect that great truth. But here's what I want to tell you. I just want to give you two or three things tonight before we leave. Two or three things about the life to come. And the very first one I want to tell you is that every person possesses an immortal soul. That's you tonight. That's me. We all here tonight possess an immortal soul. There is a man that I was reading about named Arthur Stace. Lived in Sydney, Australia. He was an alcoholic, and he learned about Jesus, recovering alcoholic. And ever since he learned about Jesus, get this, he spent 35 years of his life undetected, walking the streets there in Sydney, Australia, with a piece of chalk in his hand. And he was writing in beautiful cursive for 35 years, beautiful cursive, the word eternity. 35 years. My hand would be hurting, wouldn't yours? 35 years undetected. He spent his days walking through the cities and everywhere he could find to write that word eternity so that everybody walking down the streets would be reminded about what was most important. What would your word be? What would your word be? If you were to have some chalk in your hand and here in the sidewalks of downtown Russellville, what would your word be that you would remind people of? I hope it would be eternity. The Bible says that we need to be reminded about eternity. There is a book, Ecclesiastes, in chapter 3 at verse 11. I've always loved this. He has made everything beautiful in his time. Also, the writer there, Solomon, says he has put eternity in man's heart. Look, I don't care what society says. I really don't care what an entertainer has to say. Nobody just wants to go around once, and you won't. Because the end of your body will not be the end of you. Death is not your final existence. Jesus would say it this way. If you turn to John chapter 5, look at John chapter 5 with me. John chapter 5 at verse 28, Jesus would say this. He says, "Do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming when all who are in the tombs will hear his voice and come out, those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of judgment." Jesus reminds us that every person possesses an immortal soul. And your immortal soul will reside for eternity in one of two places. One of two places is where it's going to go. Either your soul will reside in heaven, and in heaven you're never going to be alone. Just let that sink in for a moment. You ever felt lonely in this life? In heaven you'll never be alone, where you'll have fellowship in your life that you've never experienced before. In heaven, you will finally be free from guilt. Are you feeling some guilt tonight? Am I feeling some guilt tonight? We won't feel that in heaven. We won't have guilt anymore. That won't be something we feel. The stain and the hurt of pain from sinning, you'll be completely free from all the pain. But most importantly, you know what's most important about heaven? Is that you'll be with Jesus and enjoy fellowship with him. But those who don't trust, those who don't obey Jesus, they will be assigned to a place called hell. You know, there's actually a place out there. God created a place for people who want their own agenda, who put themselves first, who are only caring about number one, and that's who they're looking out after. You know, a lot of people don't like the idea of hell. You ever tried to talk to somebody maybe at work or even at school or the factory? You try to tell them a little bit about hell. A lot of people tell preachers, don't talk about that. Don't bring up that subject. Well, certainly no. You know what? The reason why I think that is people don't want to talk about that is because when we start to talk about hell, we have to do some self-evaluating, don't we? We have to start thinking about our immortal soul, whether or not we're prepared for the day of judgment. And for some of us in the room, that makes us uncomfortable. You realize that Jesus actually said more about hell than anybody else in the Bible. I found that really interesting. He talked about the terrors of that place. He talked about how hell would be a place of utter darkness, of just darkness and no fellowship in hell. It's not a city. It's just total loneliness. Total loneliness, a place of uncomfortable misery, we're told. And sometimes we think about the idea of gnashing of teeth in Revelation. We read about that. In hell, there's not going to be a next time. There's not going to be another invitation offered to obey the gospel. But the worst part about hell is none of those things. You know what the worst part is? The worst part about that place is that God's not going to be there. God's not going to be there. And he can't stop Satan from spewing all of his poison on you. Well, you might ask, well, I mean, how could a loving God send a person there? How could God send somebody there? And I think that question, I'll be honest, I think that question sometimes reveals that we don't really understand how holy God is. We really don't understand. That's the reason why we treat sin so lightly. But understand that hell was prepared for Satan, for the devil. We talk about him sometimes. It was prepared for him and his angels. God doesn't put anyone in hell. Hell is man's choice. You can read about that in John 14. One author put it this way. I read, hell is for a person who loves sin more than they love the Savior, who loves self more than God, who loves this world more than God's word. Do you love God's word? Judgment, he says, is that moment when God looks at the rebellious and says, you made this choice. You made that choice. Every person possesses an immortal soul, and you'll be responsible for where that immortal soul spends eternity. But number two, you are a fool. Hear me out on this. You're a fool if you ignore the life to come. Years ago, there was a man I was come to learn about who was walking down the highway, and this man just, he had just this old tattered hat that he wore on his head all the time, and he's walking down the road as a really windy day, and that hat just blew off his head, and it went across six lanes of traffic, and he walks through six lanes of traffic to grab this old falling apart hat. And the story goes that as he got into about the fifth lane to grab his hat, he was struck by a car and just killed immediately. I mean, on impact. And one of those reporters wrote about this story in the newspaper. And among other things, he said this. He said, isn't it amazing? Listen to this. Isn't it amazing that we will risk everything to chase nothing? Interesting. I don't think that reporter understood just how true those words really are, because Jesus said something very similar. If you remember, he said, for what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits or loses his own soul? Or what will a man give up in return for his soul? Jesus reminds us that our soul is the most valuable possession, the MVP. So why would we risk eternity for just a few more pleasures in this world? You remember the story that we started with in Luke chapter 12? Turn back to Luke 12 if you would. You may have noticed we didn't get a chance to finish that. I want to finish that story before we leave. I want you to notice really quick what Jesus would go on to say in the story in verse 20. Luke chapter 12 and verse 20. He says, but God said to him, here's the word. I didn't make this word up. Fool, this night your soul is required of you, and the things you have prepared, well, whose will they be? So is the one who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. Well, I know what you're thinking already. You're thinking, well, that's harsh. That is really harsh words for Jesus to call a man a fool. I mean, back then it was even more harsh than it is today, I would assume. But no, Jesus was just simply making an accurate assessment of this man's life. Well, what would he see in mine? Well, what would he see in yours? You see, we're pretty good at contingency plans in this life, aren't we? We're really good at preparing for all sorts of, well, if this happens, then we'll do this. I have this plan in place to take care of this. We get insurance for that, right? We got it covered. But how foolish is it, brethren? How foolish is it to not plan for the one thing in your life and in my life that is 100% certain, and that is death. That's death. How foolish to not prepare for that moment, right? Because if you fail to prepare for that moment, you will have no one to blame but yourself. But number three, any person who trusts and obeys Jesus never really dies. Do you believe that tonight? Do you believe that? Jesus came to offer life, and that does not end when our physical life ends. I want you to turn in your New Testament to John 11. John chapter 11 at verse 25 gives us some interesting perspective. Jesus said to her, to Martha, he says, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Those weren't my words, those are Jesus' words. Do you believe this, Martha? You know, and I ask you that very question tonight. Do you believe that if you've been united, united in death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ through the waters of baptism, that he died for your sins and for mine? Do you believe that because of that, God has given you a hope that not even death can diminish if you live for him faithfully? You see, friends, that's really the heart of the gospel. One of the most quoted verses. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whomsoever would believe in him will not perish, but have everlasting, there's our word, or eternal life. I'm going to ask you this question. Do you live like you believe there's an eternity? Are you going to be able to live like that this week? Do you live as if you realize that your immortal soul will live forever? Look, our task here on earth is really only about one thing. Our task here, we might think it involves more, but ultimately boils down to one thing, one choice, and that is choosing our eternal home. You know, you can make a lot of bad choices in life. I know I have. I'll raise my hand first on that. I made some bad choices along the way, but I think I've made some pretty good choices as well, but I made a lot of bad choices, and I can survive some of those bad choices. You know, you can choose the wrong school and probably be okay. You can survive that. You can choose the wrong major and survive that, right? I think you could even choose the wrong career path, the wrong career, the wrong job, and you'd be okay. You know, you'd survive that. You choose the wrong city to live in, and you might survive that, hopefully. You choose the wrong house to live in, and you could survive that, I think. Choose the wrong pillow. That happened to me recently. I got the wrong pillow and I survived that. But there's one choice that must be made correctly. And it's the choice to live with God for all eternity. And here's the great thing about that. Tonight I'm going to tell you this, is that God loves you so much. He loves you so much. You are so valuable to him that he will not force you to choose him. Well, I like the old story about a farmer who was known as just this evil man. Just this evil man did all kinds of wicked things to people. And he passed away, and in his will, the family got together. And the will was read, and in this will, it said, "Everything that I have, I'm leaving to the devil." Well, his family said, "Yeah, we'll see something about that," when they read this will. So they took it to court, and they had all sorts of dispositions and things that they said, and they talked about it, and finally it was handed over to the court system, and the court came back and they said these words. They said, "It's been decided by the court that the best way to leave something to the devil is to allow the soil to erode on his farm, the barn to rot, the farm to grow weeds, and his house just to fall down. Because the best way to leave something to the devil is to do nothing." Wow. I had to step back on that one. The best way to leave something to the devil is to do nothing. And so tonight, before we part ways, I want you to know that we're about to go out these doors in just a little bit. And maybe you're telling yourself tonight, you know, well, no, I'm going to put off the choice to obey the Lord, to obey the gospel. You know, I'll wait for another time. I'm too hungry. I'm ready for dinner. You know, I'm out of here. Well, I'll tell you, you know, without preparing for eternity, you're making a choice tonight. You're making a choice. You're making a choice for the God of this world and to live for yourself if that's your attitude. And you'll regret that choice when eternity comes. I hope you'll take this lesson to heart and the words of Jesus to heart tonight. This lesson I started off with, YOLO. But I'll tell you that as I got to thinking about the phrase that the world and our society is made really popular, I want to change that from YOLO, you only live once, to you only live eternally, YOLI. Will you take that with you this week? Maybe it'll help you. I really hope it does. To consider where you are in your relationship with the God of heaven. And tonight it really could be that you have some sin in your life that you need to deal with. We're going to sing "I Am Resolved." What a great fitting song of invitation for those who maybe are here tonight and you've never obeyed the gospel. Hey, listen, you might be here tonight, you don't even know really about what baptism is. Well, we would love to talk to you. One of the elders here, some of the members here, these great members would love to talk to you about how you can get into a right relationship with the God of heaven. Maybe you're already a Christian, but you realize you've not been living for eternity. You have not been living with the right mindset. Well, we can help get you back in a right relationship to God. Maybe the prayers of this congregation to encourage you, whatever your need might be tonight. Would you do something for me? Would you do whatever it takes tonight to get into a right relationship with the God of heaven? Come forward now as we stand and sing.